5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello everybody, it's Ravy today, no Lee Bamba. I've not done it for quite a few weeks, so we figured it might be time I did another Twitch, because everyone clearly was missing all my flashy sounds. So today I'm going to go through a couple of things, some nice additions to GameGuru, a couple of scripts, doing a lift and also something else. But first, before we get into that, just wanted to update everybody on how we're getting on with development and the conversion. Lee has been concentrating on the 3D engine, which is looking amazing, to be honest. Really, really good. Really nice lighting. Really, really fast. Beautiful. But I'll let him tell you about that and show you when he wants to. But I've been concentrating on the C++ conversion, as you know, which is done. So what we've been working on recently is performance. So obviously converting everything to C++ was a big part of that. But moving on from that, we've looked at what can we do in the engine to make it faster anyway. One of the main things that we wanted to add in a long time ago was the occluder, which works pretty well. I mean, it did actually occlude a lot of things, but unfortunately occlude, working out what can be seen, what can't be seen, and rendering it all in software, because it's a software occluder, was fairly costly, and we found that although it was hiding a lot of objects, the time it took to actually run the occluder was more than the time that we were saving. So it's never been a lot of use, which is unfortunate. But with the new C++ version, what we've done is move that off onto its own thread. So all of a sudden, occlusion takes no time at all, and we've now got really good results from it. It's hiding a lot of things, and the speed up's very good. There's a lot of other things that have been put in there with it, a lot of things tweaked to the max, like, as you can imagine, with a big level, one of the biggest slowdowns for 3D is kind of obviously the 3D. So one of the things that you have to do on the CPU side is work out what can be seen, sort it into a list before passing it onto the GPU, and the sorting is always a big issue, because you have to go through a big list of objects and work out, can this be seen, can this be seen, can this be seen? And obviously the occluder does a lot of that work, because that runs first and cuts off a lot of things. But we've also got loads and loads of things, new stuff in there, that will just it just speeds that up. So we end up with a much shorter list to sort through and have to do it a lot less often. So there's been a big speed up on that side. The sound's been sped up. The AI's been sped up. Things like raid casts, that we found that a few enemies on screen were doing quite a few ray casts, and those ray casts were quite slow, so that's been sped up dramatically. So now I find when I'm playing, you go into an area where there's a lot of AI, you're not getting any slowdown anymore. In fact, for me, it's not hitting frame rate at all, which is really good. Other things, shadows are being occluded as well. Enemies are being occluded. Lots of things. There's a whole massive list of things. To give you an idea, numbers wise, for me, I'm getting probably 150% speed on the big levels that I test, the slowest ones. I'm getting 150% speed on what I used to get, but some of the levels, because I've got quite a good machine, so a lot of other people have been getting a lot more than that. We find that the slower the machine is, the more impact these speed ups have had. I mean, some levels have literally been 700% speed up to what they used to be in the current live version. So there is a lot of work gone into it. We've looked at almost every area, or probably actually we have looked at all areas and seen what we can do and how best to speed it up. And we've run lots of tests, rather than guessing what's slow, we've run lots of performance tests in Visual Studio and seen what takes what's taking the most time, what's hogging the CPU. We know what's hogging the GPU, which is the engine, which is what Lee's working on, so that's going to speed up as well. So when they both come together, it's going to be lightning speed. But there will be a release of the C++ version of GameGuru fairly soon. I won't say what the date is, but it's not very long, and you will see a good speed up and lots of bug fixes as well, because we've been tested initially when we were doing the C++ conversion. We just fixed any bugs that were new from that, just so we could bring it into line with the existing version. But now that's been done, we've been fixing other bugs as well. So that's all going well. So now I'm going to... Someone's mentioning my jingles. So now I'm going to get on to what I'm going to show you today, which is from something that's been requested quite a bit, and also encompasses some other things that have been requested. So the first thing that I'm going to do is show you what it is we're aiming for. And the thing that people have asked for quite a bit is lifts. We used to have lifts in older products, but we've never had it in GameGuru. So I'm going to show you how to do it without adding anything. I'm going to show you how to do it with the existing Lua commands. So let's just load it in. A lift demo. So here we go. It's not the greatest looking level in the world, but but it's not bad. It's not bad. I'm not the best level designer, but I wanted to concentrate more on what the subject was, which is the lifts. So let me just run it, and then we'll look through what it does, and then I'll talk you through how I did it. So here we go. So we've got this little building here, and we've got that pallet there, which is our lift. So I'm going to walk onto it, and up I go. We get to the top, and I can get off, which is pretty cool. And there's the lift. So if I go and stand back on it, down I go, which is pretty cool. And then over here with this great big tall building that has got that funny funny bit sticking out the top, there's another lift, but she's in the same script. This goes up a little bit faster because we'd be waiting probably 20 minutes otherwise. All the way up. Now we're at the top. We can get off that. Very high up. I don't want to be jumping off there. So now we can get back on and head all the way down again. So there's the two lifts, and they both use the same script, which is cool, so you can add as many lifts as you want. There's just one other thing that I added as well, because I thought it would be fun. Now on the subject, the reason why, the other thing I said, that it applies to other people, somebody asked about doing a game on Rails, and was it possible? It kind of is. We need a slight adjustment to one of the commands, or a new command adding, which would actually be fairly quick to add, pretty simple. But as you can see, when I stand on that lift, I'm moving up with the lift. So if that pallet was actually on the ground and moving around the level in the same way, I would be in effect on rails, and I would be able to look around and shoot. So you could do it if you put some waypoints down and got the pallet, or whatever the item is, to follow the waypoints, and then just attach the player to it. That would be on rails. Anyway, so there's the two lifts. If we run up here, this is the other thing that I did, which is quite how this works in the real world, I don't know, but we just have to imagine there's a bit of magic going on, and it's a magical conveyor belt. So we'll just get on this. And then we're off the other end. And unfortunately, there's not one going back the other way. So once you've once you've come here, you're pretty screwed, really. You're gonna have to live in that little shack thing forever. So there's the two things, both using Lua script, but not as much scripting as you would think. They're fairly quick to do. So I'm going to talk you through how I did it right now. So let's change to entity mode. So the first thing that I thought of is we want to move this up, and obviously we want to stop it at a certain point, and then we want the player to get off, be a certain distance away to switch it back to we'll get activated again, and then if the player stands on it again, you want to head back down. Now heading back down is easy because we know where the pallet is now, so we can just store that number. We know what the Y is. It is back to the future day. So yes, these are hover thingies. So we know where the bottom is because that's where it starts. So we can store that number. But how do we know where the top is? Because as you can see from both of these, they're fairly different in height. This is fairly low, and that is miles in the air. So we need some way of stopping it on the way up. So I've got this other object, which has got another script attached to it. So when this passes this, it can just set it back to this, the level, and then it knows it's reached it. So that was my basic idea. So let's just have a look at this pallet, see what the properties are. So there's the new lift lure, which I'm going to talk you through, which I wrote. Then we have got physics on for this. We've left physics on, but we can't move this pallet up when we've got physics on, so we're gonna have to turn it off. But I've left physics on because I do want to turn it back on when the lift stops, otherwise the player is just going to fall straight through it. So that's why physics is on. I've set the weight to zero, so when the pallet does stop, it's not going to fall. If it had any weight, it would fall back down to earth. So we've left it at zero. Nothing else really matters in there. It's obviously not static. That's the main things. It's not static. It's got lift lure. Its physics is on, and it's got a weight of zero, which is pretty cool. Then also, I've changed the name of this pallet to lift. And I've also changed if used to lift as well, and why that's important will become apparent in the script. So let's have a look at the scripts. Now what I'll do, tell me if you can't see this, let's shrink this up a bit, and I'll zoom in a bit on the scripts, which is not working probably because of my shortcut keys. So I'll zoom in manually. Excuse me. There we go. Hopefully that'll be clear enough. If not, let me know. There we go. So, firstly, the usual golden rules with scripts. I'm going to call it lift. Lift.lure. So it needs a lift underscore init to initialize, and a lift underscore main, and both of those with a parameter called E, which passes in the object number of that particular object. So with any commands that need to use that, we can pass that in. So outside of those, I've set up two global arrays. One is lift mode, so we know what mode that particular lift is on, and its original Y, which is what I was saying about when it's on the floor, when we're coming down, we know where to stop because we know where the original Y was. So we want to store that. So in the init function, I'm setting the mode to floor, which means it's on the floor. Then I'm setting the original Y to -9999, because at this particular point in the initialization, I don't know what the position is. So I'm setting it to -999, so I can pick that up later and say, oh, it's not been set yet, and then set it. Then player on lift mode is set to up. Now that's not in here, if you notice, player on lift mode. So what's that? Well, the other object that was at the top, the cube thingy, oops, let me just get out of that. This, I want that to be able to read a variable that this reads as well. So because it's kind of global, I wanted to put it outside of an individual script. So this player on lift mode, I've put into the global. I'll just put it at the top, which is not the best place to put it, but I'll just put it up there just for ease of showing it. And we've just set that to blank. So there's nothing relevant at the moment there. But then as you can see, play on lift mode is up, because all lifts start at the bottom. So we just set it to up in the initialization. Then into the main lift, we've set speed to 40, so it's going to go up. We'll ignore that just for now. Then we're checking for the lift. Remember what I said about the original Y? I've set it to -999. By the time we get to the main function, we've got all the information on that particular object or entity. So I can check if it's -999, and then if it is, I can set original Y to the actual Y position of the entity. It's one of the global things that are passed in. And again, you don't need to remember these things. I mean, I don't remember them. I always look it up in global. If you go to global, you can see there's all the player positions. And if you look at update entity, that's all the information that's going to be passed in. So we can see here the position is passed in. So that's what we need. So we're grabbing that, then we're all set. That'll only ever be done the once. Now we know that I set the lift mode to floor, so that's going to be the first one. So if it's floor, then it's checking player distance, which is one of the built-in functions, and if it's less than 60, then we know the player is really close to it. How did I know it was 60? I guessed. I put 80 first, and that was a little bit too far away. Then I put 40, and that was too close. So I tried 60, and that was good. So I went with that. So I just guessed, and just played around till it worked. So 60. You can normally tell if it's a fairly small object. A grid space is 100 by 100, and the player is about 100 high. It's a little bit less than that. So it gives you a rough idea. You can normally guess fairly well how big things are. So yeah. Less than 60, then we're fairly close. If you are, then I've changed lift mode to up, and I've changed that global player on lift mode to up, which I think it was anyway. So yeah, it was originally. Then, because I want it to move up, I want physics to be off, so I'm setting collision off, which normally would mean the player's going to fall straight through it, but it won't in this case. So we've changed it from floor. So if all this floor does, that's just that state, particular state, that just waits until the player gets close enough, so less than 60, then it just changes mode, switches the collision off, that's it. So now up, which is the mode that we were selected to, if we're on this mode, we're going to call another built-in command, which is move up, and that takes two parameters, E, which is the object number, which we've already passed in, and speed, which is what I set here, which is 40. And quickly, just so I do say what this was, 40 was a good speed for this little building, and probably most instances, but for the big skyscraper, it was far too slow. So I've checked here, if E is 59, then I'm changing speed to 200. Obviously we know E is passed in, but how do I know 59? How do I know it's that? Well, I know Lee has mentioned this a few times as well, but if you go over an object, if you look at the bottom, not the object, the bottom of the screen, the bottom panel, we can see as I'm hovering over that object that it is actually object number 59. So that's how I found out what it was. I just put the mouse over it, and I can see that that's object 59. Or 70059 as far as the engine's concerned, but as far as Lua's concerned, it's in entity number 59. So for our scripts, we can check if it's that particular one, and that's how I change the speed, so it's a bit different. So back to up. So you move it up by the speed, and then I use a command. You may or not have come across this before. It's been used, this command has been used to create teleports, where you can go to a zone and be teleported across the map to a different zone. So this is called transport to if used, and it passes in the E. So it transports the player to the location of if used. Now, if you remember when we were looking at this pallet, or our lift rather, I changed the name of this to lift, and I changed if used to lift. So that means if it's going up, it's going to actually teleport the player to itself, to its own location, which is why the player stands on top of the lift. So when it does transport to if used, it's actually going to teleport the guy, the player, to its very own position. So the player will follow itself up. So he won't be able to walk off the lift, but he will be able to travel up the lift with it, which is cool. Then it's got if player on lift mode equals stop, then it changes to stop. So where does this come in? Player lift mode, because as far as we're concerned, we've changed it here to up, and we've ensured it's set to up as soon as the player gets on it, this lift mode. So that is the global, if you remember, that I set in here. And what we need for that is another script. Now that's why I've got this block up here. Look at this block. This is set to lift stop, which is another script. So it'll interact with any lift that's fairly close to it. I've set this to static no, so it runs a script, and that's about it. Anything else doesn't really matter for this particular one. As long as static is no. I've set physics on to no as well, so it doesn't move. So let's have a look at lift stop, what that does. Because at the moment, this is just going to keep moving up until player on lift mode is stop, which is never, as far as this script is concerned. That's never going to happen. So if we jump into lift stop, usual things for this, underscore init, underscore main. I've got nothing to do to initialize this, so it's just blank. But then if we look at this, I'm checking the Y position, and I'm checking if it's less than the player position, minus 20. So in other words, if the player goes above this, I know that the lift has reached the height it needs to, because the player is attached to the lift. So if the player is higher than that block, then I know it's time to stop. But how comes this block didn't stop that lift? The reason I got around that, because it did when I first tried it, and the lift stopped halfway, and I thought, oh, why is that? But I'm also checking the player distance. So I'm saying if the player distance is less than 500, so that's quite large. That's probably an area about that, around here. Probably about that. Because I know there's only going to be one lift around there, and the same for this lift. By the time it gets up there, there's only going to be one lift around that block. So I just done another little double check, just to make sure it's the right block. So every block has got one lift that it's going to deal with. So if it is closer than 500 to the player, then it's going to set this global, if it is currently up, it's going to then set it to stop, which is what we wanted. So if we go back here, that's saying if lift mode equals stop, then we set its own lift mode to stop, and we put collision back on. So hopefully you can see what it's done there. It's going to keep traveling up until it gets slightly past that block. That other script's going to go, oh, right, the player's above me now, so lift mode is going up, so I'm going to set it to stop, which then lets this script know it's time to stop. So switch collision on, change the mode to stop, which is here. Now, what we want to do once you get to the top, you want the player to stand on it and go back down. But you don't want to be doing that if he's only just gone up. So what I'm doing here is checking if the player distance is greater than 100. So the player's moved away from the lift. If he has, then we set it to a new mode, which is ceiling. Because where we started off with floor, we now gone all the way to the top. So we set the new mode to ceiling. So I've split that across there, just to make it obvious that this is a different mode. This is heading down now. And heading down is basically going to mirror the going up. Apart from the fact we don't need to have any block on the ground saying, oh, I've hit the ground, because we started off from there. And we also stored the initial, the original Y position. So we already know if we pass that, it's time to stop. So this is very similar. Check if we've hit the ceiling. Check if it's ceiling mode. If the player distance is less than 60, then we can start moving down. It doesn't do it initially because we've got to be 100 units away for it to switch to this mode in the first place. So that means it's not going to constantly go up and down, up and down. The player needs to have walked away and then come back. So if it's less than 60, then he's going to be heading down, and player lift on lift mode is down, which that other script only looks for up, so it's nice and safe. So this is not relevant to going down. So then it does a similar thing to before. There isn't a move down command, there's only a move up. So to move down, I'm moving up at a negative speed. So obviously that will move down. So I'm moving up at minus speed. And then I'm doing the transport to if used again. And then I'm checking the original Y, which was the original place it started off. If the original Y is greater than the Y of the lift, then we know we've gone past it. So we then set the mode to stop floor, and then we're going to set the position just so we don't end up with the player and the lift stuck halfway through the ground. We're just going to set it to the original Y position. So you can see I'm setting position here, and then using the usual entity global variables that are passed in, but I'm using the original Y as the for the Y value, so we can set it back to where it started off in the first place. Then we've set it to stop floor. So again, stop floor, very similar to this one. We're just making sure that the player is more than 100 units away. If he is, then we know we can switch it back to the original floor mode, which means if he walks on it, then it will start all the way back here, because it'll be in floor mode again. And as soon as he gets less than 60, off he goes again. So that is lifts, and you can see there's not a massive amount of lines. We'll set 71 lines for that, plus tiny little script there of 12 lines, and you've got lifts. And all you've got to do is put this little block in, attach that script to it, lure stop, and set it to static mode no, so it runs a script on it, and turn off physics for it so it doesn't fall off. And then for the palette, attach lift lure, do set it to physics on, put the weight to zero so it doesn't fall, so gravity doesn't affect it, and then name it something relevant, lift, and set it to if used so it can teleport the player. So you're probably thinking, well, how comes the other lift works? How comes it doesn't get teleported back to this lift? If we look at this one, the properties, everything is the same apart from we'll call this lift 2. And if used is obviously set to the same name. So it teleports in there. So that's it. That's it for the lifts. Then the other things, my conveyor belt, you can see them there. There's 10 of them, and what I did to get them all to line up, I put one down, the first one, then I extracted it, held shift, and then just clicked 10 times, 9 times, so they would all be in exactly the same place. then I just clicked and used the widget and just dragged it out along one plane, so they would all be identically lined up. So I thought that was the quickest way of doing it. Otherwise it'd be, because lining 10 things up in the middle of the air can be fairly tricky otherwise. But that's the way to do it. Just put them all on the same spot and then just drag it across with the plane. So these are similar-ish to the lifts, but a little bit simpler. Because you notice when it was running, it was a constantly running like a conveyor belt. So let's look how I did that. So we're going to the properties of this. We can see this is called belt one, and just the same as the lift, I've got if use set to belt one as well. So you probably guessed every single one of those pallets along there had to click on and change it to belt two, belt three, belt four, you know, all the way up to 10. So, because you want it to be, you want it to know the exact one that you're standing on. So you just have to name them uniquely and get the if used to be the same name as name. Then I put, with these, I put physics off, because at the other side, you're going onto the terrain. You start on the terrain and you end on the terrain. So we don't need any collision ever on these pallets. So I've just set physics off for this. Now I've set them to always active, where the lifts weren't. What always active does is, normally with AI, when you get a certain distance from it, which is, I'll say a certain distance, is 3,000 units. When you get 3,000 units away from an AI, it will switch off because it's deemed to be out of range and it'll be fairly small on screen and it's not really going to have any impact on the game. So we do that for speed, which means if you've got lots of enemies around the level, they're not all going to be active all the time, only when you're within 3,000 units of them. But with these, I wanted them to work in a certain way, I wanted them to keep in moving in unison. So if I use that 3,000, you know, if I just left them as normal, if say 3,000 units is probably about here-ish, as I moved forward, the first one would start to move, and then it would go outside of range, it would stop. And then as it would move again, the next one would start, and the previous one. And anyway, the end result would be they'd all be bunched up, and it would look a right mess. So because of that, I wanted it running all the time. So that is what that particular field is. Always active, yes. So if you ever want to do a script, so say for instance it's rules to your game, or certain things that happen at a certain time, and you've just got a dummy object that you want a certain script to run, but you want it to always run no matter where the player is, that's the flag to use, always active. So I've set all those 10 things to always active, so they keep moving. And the way they work is, they're spaced out fairly evenly. I mean, I just did it by hand, but soon one of them will just keep moving, and as soon as it reaches a certain distance from the original start point, it will just get reset back to hit to the start point. But obviously I don't want this one being reset back to its start point, I just want it to be the start point of this one. So a little bit like I used an object number before, as I'm hovering over that, you can see that object is object number 43. So really I want all of these objects to reset back to the position of object 43. So doing that, just moving them away, then checking the distance, and when they get a certain distance, moving them back, gives that conveyor belt effect. So if we look at the script for that, hopefully that makes some sense. So here we go. We've got belt original X, original Y, and original Z as globals. Now they're not arrays, because I only need one. I only need that first, the furthermost one, number one, which as you can see is 43, as we just saw by highlighting it, object number 43. So I've done my usual thing of setting it to -9999, so I know it's not set. There's nothing to do in the initialization phase. So we go straight into main. Then I'm checking if original X is equal to -9999. Then I'm checking that it's the right object. So is this object number 43? Yes. So I want to store the position of the XYZ for that object, and then use it for all the other conveyor belt objects. So it's done that. If there's nothing else, it's just going to return. The reason I returned out at that point is I don't know that the first item on that conveyor belt will be run before the others. I mean, I do, because I put it down first, but I may not have, you know, there may be other ones added later on, or I may use a different one. So just to be safe, because I wanted to make sure these were set. If the particular object in question wasn't number 43, then I just wanted to return out for the next loop, because then I know that these values will definitely be set by the time the whole conveyor belt starts doing its thing. So let's assume it's gone past that. So the first loop, if it is object number 43, it's going to be set to these. It's going to store the original position. If not, it's going to do nothing at all. Then from the next loop onwards, it's going to move forward. And literally that's all it's going to do. It's just going to move forward 400, which is quite fast. Then I need to find out what the distance is from that original position to see if I need to reset it. So I'm doing the usual distance check here. So just to run to distance check, the way you do it, you take the position from and take away the position to for both X, Y and Z. So you can see I've done it there, X, Y, Z there. Then you do a square root of, you times the X by the X, so it's by itself. You do three multiplications, and you just add them all together. Get the square root of that, and that tells you the distance between those two points. So it ends up with the distance between original XYZ and the current entity XYZ. Now I'm checking if that distance is greater than 2,700. And again, you're probably thinking, well, how does he know that number? I originally I put 1,000 and just run it and see where these disappeared. They got to about here and then disappeared and back to here. So that was obviously not enough. So I put it to 2,200, which wasn't a bad guess. It was about, stopped about here. And then I guess 2,700, and it was perfect. So I went with that. So once it's greater than that, then we're setting the position back to the original one, which is the original position of 43. And they're never going to overlap, because they're all moving all the time, and they're all spaced out. So they're always going to keep that space between them, which is pretty cool. Then, if that distance is not greater than that, then I'm going to check the player distance, see if it's less than 60, which is exactly the same as what I did for the lifts. If it is less than 60, then I'm going to transport the player to it. And again, the transport to, if used, is then what I set in the properties, and I ensured that I set it to the same name. So if the player's close, then it's teleported to the position of that object itself. So it will stick to that pallet all the way across until it reaches the other side, and then this pallet will reset back to here, and the player will be far enough away and he won't get teleported to it anymore. So that is it. That's how they work. Now if these are, hopefully these have been of some use, I thought they were at least a bit of fun. What we will do is we'll put these scripts in the next build that comes out. But if you want them in the meantime, just email me, ravy@thegamecreators.com, and I'll send them to you. But that is it. So we'll have a look one more time at what it did. If there's anything, any part of that that was not clear, or that I skipped over, or I sounded like I was talking absolute nonsense, do say while I'm demonstrating it one last time. Otherwise I won't know. So here we go, the demo again. So, we'll do a big lift. And there are certain games you could do with this kind of thing as well, because what I was saying about the on rails thing, you could do like an on rails in a car with a turret, kind of going along with a turret kind of game, because where you could just move left and right. You could do that with this kind of method, and just have the pallet or whatever object you want moving, following waypoints that you put down. That would work pretty well. So you could have like a part of your game where you get on the back of a Jeep, bombing around the place and shooting. Maybe that's something I'll do in the future. If that sounds good, post on, we know we have got a forum thread which says what kind of things you want to see. If there are any wacky ideas, because we're always up for challenges, if there are any ideas that you want to see, things that you didn't think were possible in GameGuru, or things that you really want to do but know you can't do it or not sure how to, post on that thread. And what's the email again? It's ravy@thegamecreators.com. So the game creators, all one word. And just say something like, in the topic, put Twitch scripts or something, just so I know what it is, so I don't think I'm getting spammed or something. And I'll send them back to you. So we're going up this lift. I won't bother going back down it because we know it works. And then running up the big mountain once more to the conveyor belt. And then we're on the conveyor belt. And all the way along. And there we go. And so you do it. And it just, you can see there's not a massive amount of scripts. It's not that scary to do scripting. It's all quite sensible. And it's just about looking at the built-in commands and seeing what they do. That's what I do. When I thought about doing this, I thought, I'm going to do lists, how do I do it? I thought, well, we can't do it really, because it'll, you know. And then I thought, well, if I, you know, we can attach things to things, so I can do it like that. You know, there's quite often there's a way around it. The best way to learn is really just look at the built-in scripts, go through them, see what they do. The soldier one is quite good, although that's quite long and probably fairly scary to someone that's not done this kind of thing before. But these scripts are good, because you could change these and change the speed, see how how that affects it. Maybe put it in one of your games and notice that the conveyor belt doesn't go far enough, or it goes too far, and you want to change that. Having a muck about with existing stuff is probably the best way to learn. That's how I learned to program originally. It all seemed very frightening at first, but then I just started playing around with a few numbers. I'm thinking, oh yeah, that changes the speed of this. And then after a while, you think, well, what if I do this? And then it breaks. But then you work out why it breaks. And that's how you learn. So have a look through global, because that has all the globals there. These are all the things you can pick up from the player. You can tell whether the flashlight is on. So I think I showed that in one of the other Twitches, and I used the flashlight to open a gate, because you can tell whether the flashlight is on. You know, there's no complex thing you have to do. You can just say, is G player flashlight equal to 1, yes, then I'll know the flashlight's on. So there's a lot of easy ways to do a lot of things. And then all the functions that do stuff are down here. And a lot of them are named fairly sensibly, so you can work out what they do. Hide terrain, obviously, hides the terrain, that kind of thing. So, you know, most of them make sense. You can show and hide water. There's loads of them. Jump to different levels. I won't read them all out. It'd be very boring. But there's lots of things you can do. And you only need a couple of those normally to do the scripts that you want to do, like I did with my lifts. Just literally a few of those commands. And there they were. Yeah, and as Mr. Sing Commander says there, if any other questions. There's we've got a very good bunch of guys that do our support. Very friendly. They're enthusiasts themselves. They love scripting. They love mucking about in GameGuru, and they know it inside out. So if there's anything you're ever confused over, support@thegamecreators.com. They're the people to ask, because they do know their stuff. So there's also the forums on Steam, and also on GameGuru, game-guru.com. We've got forums there. You can ask. There's a lot of really good guys that use GameGuru. In fact, everyone that uses GameGuru is a really good guy or girl. And also, there's a whole guide to Lua on the Steam community, which Mr. Sin Commander has linked up in the chat, and that takes you through introduction to it, what the different commands do, and it actually goes through every single one of these functions. So if some of them look a bit strange, like modulate speed, it's not necessarily obvious what that does. Obviously it does something to the speed, but what, you know? So check out the guide that Scene Commander's linked up. That will take you through all that. So that is it. That's what I wanted to show you. If there are any other questions, please ask now. We've gone slightly over my planned 30 minutes, but I always do. So does Lee. Probably because we both talk far too much, but never mind. So hopefully that's been of interest. I'll wait a few minutes to see if there's any questions, but if there's anything you want to see, anything you fancy seeing that we've not done, or if you want to see that crazy idea about the on-rails riding around on a Jeep shooting a turret thing, or anything similar, add it, jump on the GameGuru site, go to the forum, and you'll see in, I think it's general discussion or product discussion or something like that, the general discussion bit, there's a thread right near the top that is about Twitch, and you can say what you want to see and hear about on there. So do it if there's something you want to know about. So hope that's been of some use, and I'm not sure if Lee will be on next week or me, who knows. Lee tends to do it more than me because I'm far too shy for this kind of stuff. But I will see you guys soon. So take care, everybody. Thanks for watching. And as the last thing, very important, I hope everyone has seen the Star Wars trailer. And I hope everyone's bought their tickets. If not, go get them quick. Anyway, take care, and I'll see you guys soon. Fare thee well.